Ladies and gentlemen, speaking to you from the Samuel Goldwyn Theater at the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, Mr. Burt Reynolds.
Good evening. To help the city of Los Angeles celebrate its bicentennial, the entire motion picture community has decided to share with you one of its most precious and endearing commodities, the comedy film. You're about to witness some of the most outrageously funny moments in the history of motion pictures. The title of our salute to LA's 200th birthday says it all. Hollywood, the gift of laughter. According to Dr. Sigmund Freud, laughter is based on a guilt-free release of aggression. It's a message both to and from the unconscious intended to liberate. And of course, on the other hand, it's a repression, conversely, and you can get the same results by popping your thing.
Your prize for the great pie fight.
In Hollywood, a pie in the face has always been good for a laugh. Banana peels have also come in handy. But the most durable device in comedy films is, and probably always will be, the big chase. For over 70 years, the streets of Los Angeles have been the playground of the funniest men and women in the world. From the foothills of Burbank to the beaches of Santa Monica, generations of clowns have romped along these same thoroughfares. If these zany performers shared the same territory, they also shared the same gags.
Walk this way.
No joke is sacred, the saying goes, but we're also reminded that the joke is in the telling.
Come on. Now hurry, walk this way.
To prove both points, here are some outstanding variations on a single theme. Walk this way, the most familiar gag in screen history.
Walk this way. This way.
Please walk this way.
Walk that way? I could never pass the physical.
Hey, walk this way, sir.
Well, I'll try.
Nicky, pull yourself together.
Walk this way. Walk this way.
Please. This way, gentlemen.
No, gentlemen, please. I said walk this way.
No, you walk this way.
Mark, have you any frog's legs?
No.
It's rheumatism makes me walk that way.
I knew he was going to say that.
Something familiar, something peculiar, something for everyone, a comedy tonight. Something appealing, something appalling, something for everyone, a comedy tonight. Nothing for kings, nothing for crowns. Bring on the lovers, liars, and clowns. Oh, situations, new complications. Nothing portentous or polite. Tragedy tomorrow, comedy tonight. Something convulsive, something repulsive, something for everyone, a comedy tonight.
I was reading a book the other day.
Reading a book?
Yes, it's all about civilization or something. A nutty kind of a book. Do you know that the guy says that machinery is going to take the place of every profession?
Oh, my dear. That's something you need never worry about.
Something aesthetic, something frenetic, something for everyone, a comedy tonight.
I can never have children.
I can adopt some. But you don't understand, how good? I'm a man. Well, nobody's perfect.
Nothing of gods, nothing of fate. Weighty affairs will just have to wait.
For a stroll. Not a word. Not a word.
Hold it! Hold it right there! Where are you going with that elephant?
What elephant?
And it wasn't a Newfoundland dog that bit you.
And bases,
panderers,
philanderers,
cupidity, timidity,
mistakes,
fakes,
rhymes,
mimes,
humblers, rumblers, humblers, humblers,
no royal curse, no Trojan horse, and there's a happy ending, of course. Goodness and badness, man in his madness, this time it all turns out all right.
another nice mess you've gotten me into.
Hollywood, heart of the motion picture industry, home of the dream factories, the most popular art form of the 20th century. The movies are also a multi-billion dollar business, demanding intense dedication and discipline.
Throw out your hands, take out your tush, hands on your hips, give them a push.
You're doing here? This is a closed set.
Are you crazy?
I'm working for Mel Brooks.
Not in the face. Thank you.
This is the subtle handiwork of Mel Brooks, actor, writer, director, and major comedy force. To provide helpful insights into the master's work, here is my friend and my colleague, Dom DeLuise.
Mel Brooks stands with Neil Simon and Woody Allen as a member of today's big three in motion picture comedy. In comparing these three talented creators, it should be pointed out that Mr. Simon is the tallest, Mr. Allen is the thinnest, and Mr. Brooks is by far the craziest. So much for comparisons. Coincidentally, these three gentlemen started in the 1950s as comedy writers for the hit TV series Your Show of Shows, starring Sid Caesar. A decade later, they were all off and running, each in their own direction. Mr. Brooks' movie career began in 1967 when his first feature film was released. And I'd like to read some of the comments from the most prominent critics of that time. Amateurishly crude, lewd and hideous, thoroughly vile and inept, perverse, obnoxious, outrageous, offensive, tasteless, and possibly the worst film of the year. In response to this unexpected hostility, Mr. Brooks did a very clever thing. He walked off of the Oscar that same year for the best original screenplay. So much for critics. That much maligned film, written and directed by Mel Brooks, was this classic, The Producers, starring my friend Gene Wilder and the very gifted Zero Mostel.
May I speak to you for a minute?
Go. You have 58 seconds.
Well, in glancing at your books, I noticed that in the columns...
You have 48 seconds left. Hurry, hurry.
Oh, I glanced at your books, I noticed in the...
28 seconds. You're running out of time.
Mr. Bialystock, I cannot function under these conditions. You're making me extremely nervous.
What is that, a handkerchief?
Nothing, it's nothing.
If it's nothing, why can't I see?
My blanket! My blue blanket! Give me my blue blanket! Oh, no, 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 no,
no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no,
no, no. I'm sorry. I don't like people touching my blue blanket. It's not important. It's a minor compulsion. I can deal with it if I want to. It's just that I've had it ever since I was a baby, and I find it very comforting.
Turning to the classics, Mr. Brooks next gave us Young Frankenstein. It starred Gene Wilder and Terry Garr.
It seems louder over here. Hand me that candle, will you? Put the candle back. All right. I think I have it figured out now. Take out the candle, and I'll block the bookcase with my body.
Now listen to me very carefully. Don't put the candle back. With all of your might, shove against the other side of the bookcase. Is that perfectly clear?
I think so.
good girl.
Put the candles back!
Mel Brooks shocked the film industry with his next project. He starred himself, along with the great Dom DeLuise, Marty Feldman, and his old friend Sid Caesar, in a film that dared to be different. Silent movie. If you liked Hitchcock, then you had to love High Anxiety. Mr. Brooks' salute to the master of suspense, which co-starred the inimitable Madeleine Kahn.
Hello? Listen, mister, I don't go for this sort of thing. I know a lot of the other girls are turned on by these sort of kinky phone calls, but I really couldn't care less. How did you, get my room number? I am not going to listen to any more of this. I mean, I've had just about enough. What are you wearing? Jeans? You're wearing jeans?
Yeah.
I bet they're tight. You are an animal!
Vicky! Victoria! It's me, Richard!
Richard! Richard! Richard! No, Richard! Richard, I knew it was you. I knew it was you all the time. I just went along with it. I laughed. Did you laugh?
I shall give you my laws, and you shall take them unto the people.
Yes, Lord!
In History of the World, Mr. Brooks chose to play several key roles, such as Moses, the lawgiver.
Lord, I shall give these laws unto thy people. Hear me! Oh, hear me! All pay heed! The Lord Jehovah, has given unto you these 15... Ten commandments for all to obey.
Your Majesty, I must have a word with you.
With Harvey Korman as his minister, here is Mr. Brooks again in a graceful portrayal of King Louis the 16th.
I've come on the most urgent of business. Yes. It is said that the people are revolting.
You said it. They stink on ice.
No, Your Majesty, this is a very serious problem. The peasants feel you have no regard for them.
What? I have no regard for the peasants? They are my people. I am their sovereign. I love them. Ho! Drifting to the left.
Uh-oh! We had better kiss soon!
Why?
We're coming to the end! See? Oh, my darling! Oh, my darling!
Big ending!
Mel Brooks, King of Chaos. Long live the king. This is the last remaining example of Hollywood's most endangered species, the comedy team.
Hey, Holmes, why don't you come along?
Meet Cheech Marin and Tommy Chong.
And take a little trip with Cheech and Chong.
Cheech and Chong have a young and rather specialized audience,
But with a little patience, even us old fogies can learn to appreciate their spaced-out humor.
Hey, what happened?
Hey, you all right?
My cow!
With Cheech in trouble, it's Chong to the rescue.
Hey, what happened, man? Come on, man, let's go. Push. You're not trying. Okay, one more. Come on, push.
Come on,
you're not trying.
Hey, that's good, buddy.
Hey, look at me. Come on. Oh, man.
Olson and Johnson have arrived.
Huh? How do you know?
I am Sherlock Holmes. I know everything.
Mr. Wagstaff is in conference. Do you have an appointment?
No, we don't need an appointment.
We're Olson and Johnson.
Olson and Johnson!
Shy little thing, isn't she?
Are you the Ritz brothers?
Huh? Of course we are. Here's our picture, boys. The name is Ritz. R-I-T-Z. R as in Ritz. I as in me.
T as with lemon.
And Z as in
Zazuzaz.
With the coming of sound, Broadway headliners like Olson and Johnson and the Ritz Brothers brought years of professional experience to the screen. But the most durable comedy team in movies began in the silent era. Hal Roach's Our Gang would utilize the talents of over 40 little rascals. Among the alumni, Jackie Cooper, who would soon become the most popular child star of his era. Carl Alfalfa Switzer. George Spanky McFarlane. Billy Buckwheat Thomas. Matthew Stymie Beard. Another future child star, Scotty Beckett. Their best girl, Darla Hood. And little Mickey Gubitosi, who would grow up to become an actor with a new name, Robert Blake. Ventriloquist Edgar Bergen and sidekick Charlie McCarthy were the most famous one-man team in show business. The Dead End Kids, the Bowery Boys, however you knew them, Leo Gorcey and Hunts Hall were the ringleaders. Two fine actors, Myrna Loy and William Powell, teamed up with a dog named Aster in the enormously successful Thin Man comedy. Penny Singleton and Arthur Lake played Mr. and Mrs. Dagwood Bumstead in the delightful Blondie films. Two character actors, Percy Kilbride and Marjorie Maine, became major comedy stars in the Ma and Pa Kettle films. The unlikely team of Donald O'Connor and Francis the Talking Mule were a huge box office success, but they were the last of a great era of comedy teams. This kind of humor was better suited to a new medium, television.
Take it.
Oh, bring back my Bonnie to me.
Ironically, it was television that revived the popularity of the Three Stooges. Larry Fine and Moe and Curly Howard first appeared in films as the anonymous members of a comedy team known as Ted Healy and his Stooges. When Healy decided to go it alone, the boys mistakenly thought that their brief film career was over.
None of that. What else do you guys do?
We got routine.
We got the old routine.
We got the old routine.
Who's asking you? None of that. Are you guys brothers?
Yeah, we're triplets.
Triplets? How old are you?
28. 19.
None of that lying.
Ain't I 19?
You're 28.
19.
28.
19.
In 1934, Columbia Pictures took a chance on these lowbrow comics and signed them for a few two-reelers.
What are you doing?
Today, thanks to television, the painless violence of the Three Stooges is still as infectious as ever.
Hey, any of your clothes on that line?
No.
And stay out of it.
He's just as scared as you are. Act like this is nothing to you. Make him believe you've been a fighter.
In the 50s, nightclub sensations Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis became Hollywood's hottest team.
I wouldn't let anything happen to you, would I?
We'll soon find out.
We'll put on the act right now. Go ahead. Listen, Melvin, how long been fighting?
I've been fighting now for about 60 years.
16?
Yeah. Oh, it's about 60 years.
16, wait a minute.
16, 40, 50, 16.
16, oh, yeah. Sure.
How many fights have you had altogether? Altogether now, when you add them up, I had hundreds of one fights, hundreds of one.
Yep.
I win them all for 100.
Oh. Well, who was your toughest fight?
The toughest fight I had was with, Gene Tierney. That was the toughest fight.
Ah, you mean Gene Tunney.
You fight who you are, I fight who I want.
Oh, yeah.
Yes?
Universe's most sensational comedy team outside.
Oh, Abbott and Costello. We'll send them right in.
The critics dismissed them, but the kids loved them. They constantly quarreled off-screen, but on-screen, Bud Abbott and Lou Costello were the most popular comedy team of the 1940s.
Now, wait, get away from there. Costello, what's the matter with you?
Oh, I'm a bad boy.
Oh, behave yourself.
I've got $10.
$10? Why, certainly. Now, wait a minute. I had a $10 bill here a minute ago. Have you got two tens for a five?
Yeah.
There we are. Now, there's your ten. Come on. What's the matter with you? Something wrong?
Yeah, $15 went south.
What do you mean?
You gave me a lot of fast talk. You see, I got two tens for a five and I give it to you.
Oh, you did. Wise guy. Okay, here's your five. Give me back my two tens.
That's better.
Now get out of here.
Okay.
All right, now you want
to...
Ten more to you. That's the idea. How about you, friend? Oh. All right, tell you what I'll do. I'll wait out here. You go in there.
No, sir, brother. You're going to put that over on me.
All right. Then you go in there and I'll wait out here.
That's better.
He's a killer. So what? You've got to go in there and capture him. So long. Now, wait a minute. Come here.
I'm not going in there.
Now, listen.
Why don't you go in?
All right. We'll gamble. See who goes in.
Okay.
All right. Take a number.
Four.
No. Number three. You lose. Go on in. Go ahead.
What?
Go on!
Let's gamble odd and even like this.
What do you want to do? Cheat?
No. Give me a chance to ask you a number.
Go ahead.
You take a number.
Number two. Tell her.
I'll tell her where she.
Where is who? I said tell her.
Tell her what?
Tell her nothing. I want to tell her.
Well, go ahead and tell her. I don't care.
No. Tell her in the bank.
Tell her in the bank. Tell her outside. Tell her any place you want. I won't listen.
The most famous comedy routine of all time, Abbott and Costello, Who's On First?
Well, let's see. We have Who's On First, What's On Second, I Don't Know Who's On Third.
That's what I want to find out.
And then I say Who's On First. What's on second? I don't know who's on third.
Yeah, you know the fellow's names?
Yes.
Well, who's on first?
Yes.
I mean the fellow's name?
Yes.
I mean the guy playing first?
Who?
The fellow playing first?
Who?
The first baseman?
Who?
The guy playing first?
Who is on first?
What are you asking me for?
I'm not asking you, I'm telling you. Who is on first?
I'm asking you who's on first.
That's the man's name.
Well, go ahead and tell me.
That's the man's name.
That's whose name?
Yes.
Well, go ahead and tell me.
Who?
The guy on first base.
Who?
The fellow playing first.
Look. Who is on first?
Have you got a first baseman?
Yes.
Who's playing there?
Yes.
All I'm trying to find out is what's the guy's name on first base?
No, wait a minute. No, wait a minute. Don't mix them up. What is on second?
Who's on second?
No, who is on first?
I don't know.
He's on third now. We're not talking about him.
How did I get on third base?
You just mentioned his name.
If I mention the third baseman's name, who did I say is playing third?
No, who's playing first?
Never mind first. I don't know. What's the guy's name on third base?
What's on second?
Who's on second?
Who's on first?
I don't know.
Third base.
Have you got a third baseman?
Certainly.
Then who's playing third?
Who is playing first?
What's playing first?
Then what's on second?
I don't know.
Third base.
Have you you got a catcher?
Well, naturally.
The catcher's name?
Today.
Today. And tomorrow's pitcher.
Now you've got it.
That's all. We got a couple of days on the team.
Well, I can't help
it. But I used to be a catcher, too. I'll get behind the plate and do some fancy catching.
Yes.
Tomorrow's pitching on my team, and the heavy hitter gets up.
Yeah.
Joseph Valentine, the heavy hitter. Now, Valentine gets up, and he bunched the ball.
Mm.
Now, when he bunched the ball, me being a good catcher, I'm going to throw Valentine out of first base, so I pick up the ball and throw it to who?
Now, that's the first thing you've said right.
I don't even know what I'm talking about!
That's all you have to do.
All I know is I throw the ball to first base. Now, whoever it is drops the ball, so Valentine runs to second.
Yes.
Now, I pick up the ball, and I throw it to who? Whoever it is drops the ball, he throws it to what? What throws it? I don't know. Throws it back to tomorrow. A triple play.
That's right.
Another guy gets up, and it's a long fly ball to be caught. Why? I don't know. He's on third, and I don't give a damn. I don't give a damn.
Oh, that's our shortstop.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 6 against 12. Well, looks like it's a little uneven. You guys will have to go back to Houston and get some more guys.
Only a few actors have mastered the action comedy. One of that special group is Burt Reynolds.
We may be in trouble. We are definitely in trouble.
Bert is about as macho as a guy can get. Yet he has the unique ability to make us laugh at him and with him. And both at the same time.
Give me your hand, will you? Cute, really cute.
What sets Bert apart from most other leading men is a particular quality that women find hard to resist, that behind his charm and sex appeal lurks a naughty little boy.
Oh, we're gonna have a carnival at school to raise money. We have it every year. It's a lot of fun. It's kind of fun. I think you should come. Well, if you do like it, that
is. Oh! Aren't you a little old for this?
Fasten your seatbelt, please. Your seatbelt?
Go to
the office.
You got anything cool in there?
Okay. You okay?
I'll be okay. I'm one of those white knuckle flyers, you know. I just fall apart like a $2 suit on the takeoff.
Can I get you a drink, sir?
Ever since my helicopter went down in Vietnam, I've been like that.
Your helicopter went down?
Yeah, I don't want to talk about it, though. I'll be
cool.
So I'll be all right. I'll be okay. Just listen. Would it be all right? I know it's really an imposition. Would it be all right if I went back here in the back and sat with you on the takeoff? Because I need somebody to talk to. They won't talk to me. I know you're not allowed, but you can break the rules. Make good. Really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
I saw that, you little freak. Did you pinch me? Is that the way you get your jollies, huh? Oh, me? I certainly didn't, lady. I got a drink in one hand and a briefcase in the other. It's true.
How could he have pinched me? He has something in both hands.
Put it down and grabbed you and then picked it back up again. It's a good thing I was here. Is that the way you get your jollies, grabbing people like
it
that?
It certainly is not. I should have met my friend someplace else.
You meet somewhere in a massage parlor?
I think you're a very disturbed man.
I am. You disturb me a great deal.
What kind of...
I think I'm in love with you. I don't want to be pushy, but...
Is this guy bothering you, Alexis?
Outrageous.
Oh, look, the health club's here. Everything all right here, Alexis?
Yes, everything's just fine. Thank you.
Oh, sorry. Do you mind holding this? Thank you.
Action comedy seems to suit Bert best, and the Reynolds touch has never been more appealing than in the Smokey and the Bandit films. With Sally Field by his side and the law closing in, the dashing hero and the naughty boy are a perfect blend.
That's not good.
It would be better.
bridge.
And that's worse.
Why don't you just drop me off here? I'll catch a cab.
Too late now. Not me.
As successful as he is, Burt Reynolds has openly admitted that there's one actor he very much envies. But then again, who wouldn't?
Hello. Well, you lead one a very merry chase, very merry indeed.
You can't be serious.
I've never been more serious in my life.
Why are you imitating Tony Curtis?
I'm not imitating Tony Curtis, I'm imitating Cary Grant.
Doing Tony Curtis doing, Cary Grant.
Oh.
I'd go miles and miles on my hands and knees over broken bottles just for a little kid.
Why, I'd murder just to see the soft green shadows through that pine tree on your lovely hair.
Oh, Lisa, I love you. I'll always love you.
There never was a night like this. There never was a girl like you.
Debonair, Cary Grant. The words are synonymous. During his 34 years on screen, he became the epitome of the graceful, romantic hero. And to top it off, he's among the wittiest of all actors. It seems he's always been that way.
And love divided by two.
Will you do something for me?
A needle?
No, it's simpler than that.
In his comedies like Bringing Up Baby with Katharine Hepburn, Cary projects a man who is forever at odds with the objects of his affection.
And I'll count to ten, and when I take my hand down, you will be gone. One.
Well, I like that. I was only trying to be nice.
Thank you. Oh, just a minute.
What is the matter with you?
Well, you see,
do you realize that you're making a perfect fool of yourself? Now, look here, you can't tell me that I'm your coat. There's such a thing as being fair. Will you please stop doing that with your hat?
Well, just stand there, will you?
What in the world is going on here?
Oh, no, please don't move.
Oh, I've had about enough of this.
Now, look, listen to me. Let's get out of here. Just start walking.
So now you want to walk. Well, I'm quite sure that I don't want to walk with you. And I hope you realize that you've made a perfect spectacle of yourself. Have you finished?
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Oh, don't just stand there. Do something. Do something. Oh, my goodness. Well, get behind me.
I am behind you.
Well, get closer.
I can't get any closer now. Now, you ready? Jesus. I'll be calm. Left foot first.
All right. You're going straight out the door.
Yes, but I have to meet somebody here. Oh, there he is.
Don't you dare leave me.
I'll be with you in a minute, mister. I'll be with you in a minute, sir. I'll see you in a minute, sir. I'll see you in a minute.
Certainly do appreciate all those charming things you had to say about me. If ever I get the chance, I hope I can do as much for you.
Oh, it was nothing at all, Lucy. I try to go through life.
I know, spreading a little sunshine as you go.
Oh, I've come out from behind those clouds. I've taken a definite turn for the better. Nothing's gonna hurt me anymore.
Oh, that's too bad, Jerry. Oh, did it hurt you much?
Oh, no.
Just the one hand?
Yes, just the one hand.
Oh.
Well, I'll be going. I always like to leave people laughing.
Listen, Walter.
Listen, I made a great reporter out of you, Hildy, but you won't be half as good on any other paper, and you know it. We're a team. That's what we are. You need me, and I need you, and the paper needs both of us.
Sold, American.
Oh, all right, go ahead.
Listen, Walter, please. Mm-hmm. The paper's going to have to get along without me. So are you. That didn't work out, Walter.
Well, it would have worked out if you'd been satisfied with just being editor and reporter, but not you. You had to marry me, spoil everything.
I wasn't set. I suppose I proposed to you.
Well, you practically did, making goo-goo eyes at me for 2 years until I broke down. Oh, Walter. And I still claim I was tight the night I proposed to you. If you'd have been a gentleman, you'd forgotten all about it, but not you.
Why, you...
Oh, you're losing your eye. You used to be able to pitch better than that. Hello? Yeah, what?
Mr. Shane?
Yes, Kathy?
Oh, Mr. Shane, I'm sorry.
You couldn't help it.
But I don't want to ruin your evening.
Now, you get a good night's sleep. I'll be out here on the couch.
And if you wake up in the middle of the night and need anything, just call me.
Oh, I won't wake up. Once I get in bed, I'm through.
Yes, I know.
Mr. Eklund is a rude, foul-mouthed, drunken, filthy beast.
Well, be that as it may.
This is the filthy beast speaking. Now listen, Frank, when you send those supplies, send plenty of whiskey. Plenty.
I insist you do nothing of the kind, Commander.
I have prepared a list.
Hold it. You've taken note of everything else, but the radio is still my responsibility. 890s.
A critic once pointed out Cary Grant's secret as a comedy actor. He has that rare ability to make fun of his dignity without ever losing it.
Say that a good comedian has to be a good actor. Well, sometimes good comedians can be great actors. Gene Wilder has proven it often enough. And now you're about to see some examples of others who possess that remarkable ability. First up is a gentleman who for years had the reputation as the comedian's comedian. He also has been called the best straight man ever. When he and his partner began their career in the mid-20s, neither of them imagined that one day they would become the most successful husband and wife comedy team in show business history. The year, 1937. The film, Damsel in Distress. Here they are in top form, ladies and gentlemen, George Burns and Gracie Allen.
Here, sharpen this pencil. Did you type that letter I dictated last night?
Well, no, I didn't have time, so I mailed them my notebook. I hope they could read my shorthand.
You mailed your notebook? You know, Gracie, I'm beginning to think that there's nothing up here.
Oh, George, you're self-conscious. There.
That's it, huh?
Yes.
I'm not in.
He's not in?
Find out who it is.
Oh. Who? It's a Hawaiian.
A Hawaiian?
Well, he must be. He says he's brown from the morning sun.
Look, the man's name is Brown. The Morning Sun is the newspaper he's working on. But oh. Tell him I'm not here.
Oh, he's not here. I tell you, he's not here. Oh, you don't, huh? Well, you can ask him yourself if you don't believe me. George, will you tell him you're not here? He doesn't believe
Hello.
Me.
Over 30 years went by before George Burns returned to the movies in The Sunshine Boys with Walter Matthau.
Stand here and insult me if you want to rise the sketch. I would
like to... And in a comeback to end all comebacks, George won an Oscar as Best Supporting Actor.
Stand there and say knock, knock, knock.
I hope I can get out again.
I hope so, too. Knock, knock, knock.
Knock, knock, knock.
Enter!
What do you mean, enter? What happened to come in?
It's the same thing, isn't it? Enter or come in, what's the difference as long as you're in?
The difference is we've done this sketch 11,000 times, and you always said come in. Suddenly, today it's enter. Why today, after all these years, do you suddenly change it to enter?
I'm trying to freshen up the act.
Who asked you to freshen up the act? They asked for the doctor sketch, didn't they? The doctor sketch starts with come in and not enter. You want to freshen up something? Put some flowers in here.
What's bad about enter instead of come in?
Because it's different. You know why we've been doing it the same way for 43 years? Because it's good.
And you know why we don't do it anymore? Because we've been doing it for 43 years. If
we're not doing it anymore, why are we changing it?
Look, I don't want to argue with you. After you say knock, 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 I'm going to say enter. If you don't like it, you don't have to come in.
If you say enter after I say knock, 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 I'm coming in all right, but not alone. I'm bringing a lawyer with me.
From where? From New Jersey? You're lucky if a cow comes in with you.
Against you in court, I could win with a cow.
The finger? You're starting with the finger again?
With a knife? Are you crazy?
Next time you give me the finger, say goodbye to the finger.
I got a terrific idea. Instead of working together again, let's never work together again. You're crazy.
I'm crazy. Huh? I'm crazy?
Keep saying it until you believe it.
Please, God, make a move. I'll never be a bad person again, I promise.
Walter Matthau is Hollywood's master of frustration.
All right. We're going to get you dressed and down into a cab.
In California suite, he must get rid of an unwelcome visitor before his wife, Elaine May, arrives. In situations like this, Walter is simply incomparable.
Come on, Dolly. Push. Get your leg in there. Get your foot in there and push. Come on. Push, darling. Push. Get your feet. Feet in here. Come on. Tip it. Push. Legs up. And push. Get the feet in. Come on. Come on. You're not going to help me, right? Think. Think, Marvin. Think. Think. Change rooms. Let some other idiot get stuck with her. Hello, operator. Get me the front desk, please. This is an emergency.
Oh, one moment, Mr. Michaels. May I help you, ma'am?
Marvin Michaels. I'm Mrs. Marvin Michaels.
Oh, he's on the phone now. Suite 203.
Thank you. Would you tell him I'll be right up?
Mr. Michaels?
Who's here? My wife. My wife is here. You sent my wife up here without calling me? What the hell kind of a cheap hotel are you running here? Well, send somebody to stop her before she sees this bed. It could ruin her entire vacation. I could jump. With two broken legs, she'd never be angry with me. Oh, my God.
Marvin?
Oh, God. Mr. Braxton, in my 30 years on the bench, I have never seen a criminal record equal in intensity and downright antisocial uselessness as your own.
As an actor and as a comedian, Richard Pryor has succeeded in finally presenting black humor on the screen with all its richness and style and tact. Richard's a man for all audiences, as he so ably proves in Busting Loose.
Defrauding a chicken franchise?
Oh, I can explain it.
Braxton, you have already spent 3 years in a home for juvenile offenders, 6 years in state prison, and 4 years on probation under the guidance of that gentleman over there. Now, before I pass sentence, do you have anything to say for yourself? It's on.
Your Honor, I'd like to make a confession. I did it on purpose. Yes. I wanted to go back to prison.
You what?
I mean, doesn't it make sense anybody to hold up a store in broad daylight, stay 45 minutes, must want to go back to prison, right?
Braxton, you are talking about 5 to 10 years.
I know that, Your Honor. But I want you to give me 20 years. I gotta have 20 years. I can't go back on parole. Not with that man. The man's a racist. He's an animal, Your Honor. I mean, he looks black, right? But he ain't black. He's white as you are. No offense. I'm telling you, he treats black people like dog poo. Yeah. 4 years I've been on parole as hell. It's worse than being in the Ku Klux Klan, being under that man. I'm telling you, Honor, you gotta help me. You can't allow me.
The prisoner will come to order.
Your Honor, please send me back to prison. 3 meals a day. And let me snipe and wrestle. Get
let
my hands
go of me.
What do you mean, let go?
You 10 years probation.
No! Test probation! Oh, no!
Get that man out of my courtroom.
I'll get you for this. You dirty
get him
man.
Out of my courtroom.
I'll get you.
Great show, Braxton. One hell of a performance.
Well, you know. Yeah.
Us actors must do what we do.
Yeah.
All I did is happen to meet you in the park.
Jack Lemmon began his remarkable film career in 1954 when he made his debut in It Should Happen to You, co-starring Judy Holliday.
And furthermore, different people do different things that may seem crazy to other different people. That doesn't make it.
Correct.
And furthermore, do me a favor and butt out!
Oh, would you please do me a favor?
Like what?
Like, do you remember my name?
Sure.
Or what?
Pete Shepard.
Well, do me a favor and forget it.
Oh!
So is it still on for Friday lunch?
Certainly.
Thank you very much.
Don't mention it.
In the early days, his studio seemed unsure of Jack Lemmon's future. Perhaps he belonged in musicals. While his bosses were still wondering, Jack was loaned out to another studio for Mr. Roberts and promptly won a supporting Oscar. Suddenly, everyone in Hollywood knew where Jack Lemmon was heading.
Yes, who is it?
Captain, it is I, Ensign Pulver, and I just threw your stinking palm tree overboard.
Now, what's all this crud about no movie tonight?
And so, 20 years in a career of a great comic and a great actor is underway.
Up, I hear the subway better than I hear it in the subway. Well, like some kind
time
of
passes, styles change, but in films like Prisoner of Second Avenue with Anne Bancroft, Jack Lemmon continues to delight us as a well-meaning guy who can never quite catch up with an ever-changing world.
2 o'clock in the morning, you believe it's still going on next door?
What's going on?
What, are you trying to be funny? You don't hear that? You must be deaf.
I must be deaf. I don't hear a thing.
Well, listen, for God's sake. You don't hear the beep, beep, beep of the tom-tom as the jungle shadows fall and the tick, tick, tock of the stately clock as it stands against the wall night and day. You don't hear that?
Not when you're talking or singing or whatever it is you're doing, I don't.
It's those two German airline hostesses. Every night they got somebody else in there. Two hockey players, two basketball, whatever team's in town. Win or lose. Nobody loses when they wind up in there. Somewhere there's a 747 flying around. Everybody's serving themselves because those two broads never leave the apartment. Holy... Come here. Tell me you can't hear that.
Yes, now I hear it.
Is it any wonder I can't sleep at night?
Don't sleep with your head next to the wall. Sleep in the bedroom.
Oh, will you knock it off in there? It is 2 damn o'clock in the morning. I cracked the wall. I barely touched it, and I cracked the wall. It's lucky I wasn't trying to hang a picture. We all could have been killed.
Could we have the name, please?
Bond. James Bond.
James Bond. James Bond?
Yes, James Bond.
Yes, James Bond.
Even I'm not sure who I am, Peter Sellers once said. And in a remarkable career that spanned 30 years and over 50 films, he proved his theory again and again.
Mr. President,
I want you to meet my very dear friend, Mr. Chauncey Gardner.
On television, Mr. President, you look much smaller.
Oh? Really? You mean you don't know my name?
No.
Nor who I am.
Should I?
Well, I am Robert Danvers.
Are you Dr. Pratt? Are you from the police? No. Then I am Dr. Pratt, yes.
I am Inspector Clouseau of the Sûreté.
Peter Sellers, despite his many aliases, will always be remembered as Inspector Clouseau, the world's most inept detective.
There is something that I am very interested to know. This room is...
Look, what happened? What?
You fell off the sofa, you stupid...
I know I fell off the sofa, madame. There's no need to tell me. Everything I do is carefully planned, madame.
We don't have much of a description. About 5'7".
We must find that woman.
I will apprehend this culprit within 24 hours.
Regardless of his many disguises, audiences never failed to recognize and appreciate the talents of Peter Sellers. He remains one of the funniest and most gifted actors ever to appear on film. Once upon a time, this was a tree-shaded country road. Now, Hollywood Boulevard is a tourist attraction famous the world over. To tell you more about it is a lady who really knows the territory. She's quite a famous attraction herself, Carol Burnett.
A cynic once called this crossroads a combination of Times Square and the Boulevard of Broken Dreams. And in some ways, that's a pretty accurate description. I mean, where else in the world could you walk all over the people you admire and not feel guilty? Well, that's what everyone does who comes here and takes a stroll along Hollywood's Walk of Fame. Over 1,700 famous and forgotten celebrities have their star embedded in this unique sidewalk. A select few are practitioners of a rare and ancient art. In the world of comedy, they are a special breed, the clowns. Whoever the cut-up was that first stood in front of the fire and made primitive men and women laugh at his antics, well, that was the first clown. Now, the bad news is we have no footage of that historic event. However, the good news is that as far as this century goes, we have on film the very best of that grand tradition.
You own a whirlwind.
Hollywood's most beloved clown on screen and off had to be Jimmy Durante. In a priceless routine from a forgotten film called You're in the Army Now, Jimmy shared the spotlight with another great clown, Bill Silvers.
Homer, your singing will never help us make a sale. Now, how many times have I told you to sing correctly?
I'm open for suggestions.
Now, that's the way I like to hear you talk.
All right, now?
Just pardon us a moment, won't you, please? All right, now, nice and loose. You see, your singing is from the mask. Loose. That's fine. What was that high note you just hit? That high note?
C.
C. Fine. Sing
C.
C. Deep breath.
Don't use the hands.
Please, don't tell me how to give a lesson. Please.
I'm open for suggestions.
All right, now, just loose.
C. C.
Breath. Take your breath. Loose. C. Throw it. C. Project. C.
C. C.
No.
C.
Homer, you're not listening. Now listen. Notice how clearly I sing that. Now you try it. When the sound...
Breath! Don't use the hands.
Homer, please.
I'm open for suggestions.
All right, I'm doing this for you. Head up. Loose. That's a good boy. You're doing fine. Loose. That's fine. Now, what song would you like to sing shall we say, of a popular nature.
Sweet Georgia Brown.
Oh, yes, I love that song. Head up, nothing.
Sweet Georgia Brown.
Sweet breath.
Always take your breath, Homer.
Head up, sweet Georgia Brown.
Sweet.
Throw your voice.
Georgia Brown.
Throw it.
George.
I can't hear you. Throw your voice, Georgia Brown.
Georgia Brown.
My hands down, loose. I must frame your mouth into the proper oval so you can sing it correctly. Now, here we go. That's fine.
Sweet Georgia Brown.
Sweet Georgia Brown.
I can't hear you. Sweet Georgia Brown.
Sweet Georgia Brown.
Throw your sweet Georgia Brown.
Sweet Georgia Brown.
Let me frame it properly. Visualize Georgia Brown far away.
Hey, Georgia Brown.
What are you saying, hey, Georgia Brown?
Don't use the hands.
Oh, I can't help you, Homer. You keep fighting me. We'll have to continue these lessons some other time.
I'll be open for suggestions.
All right.
The treasure of the Pharaohs! Behold!
Danny Kaye, one of Hollywood's most versatile clowns.
It lives. It breathes. It laughs. It cries. It thinks.
Sir Giacomo, you should be an armor. A new machine in the stands.
A master of fast-paced patter, Danny Kaye gave us this classic in The Court Jester with Mildred Natwick and Glennis Johns.
Listen, I put a pellet of poison in one of the vessels.
Which one?
The one with the figure of a pestle.
The vessel with the pestle?
Yes, but you don't want the vessel with the pestle. You want the chalice from the palace.
I don't want the vessel with the pestle. I want the chalice from the what?
The chalice from the palace.
Hmm?
It's a little crystal chalice with the figure of a palace.
Does the chalice from the palace have the pellet with the poison?
No, the pellet with the poison's in the vessel with the pestle.
Oh, the pestle with the vessel.
The vessel with the pestle.
What about the palace from the chalice?
Not the palace from the chalice. The chalice from the palace.
Where's the pellet with the poison?
In the vessel with the pestle.
Don't you see? The pellet with the poison's in the vessel with the pestle.
The chalice from the palace has the brew with it. It's true.
So easy. I can say it.
Well, then you fight him.
Listen carefully. The pellet with the poison's in the vessel with the pestle. The chalice from the palace has the brew that is true.
Or the pellet with the poison's in the vessel with the pestle. The chalice from the palace has the brew that is true.
Good man.
Just remember that.
Sir Giacomo. Sir Giacomo, into your armor. And you to your place in the pavilion.
Pellet with the poison. The pellet with the poison's in the vessel with the pestle. The chalice from the palace has the true that is brewed. I've got it. I've got it. The pellet with the poison's in the vessel with the pestle. The chalice from the palace has the brew that is true, right?
Right. But there's been a change. They broke the chalice from the palace.
They broke the chalice from the palace?
And replaced it with a flagon.
A flagon.
With the figure of a dragon.
A flagon with a dragon.
Right.
But did you put the pellet with the poison in the vessel with the pestle?
No. The pellet with the poison's in the flagon with the dragon. The vessel with the pestle has the brew that is true.
The pellet with the poison's in the flagon with the dragon. The vessel with the pestle has the brew that is true.
Just remember that.
Yes, thank you very much. The pellet with the chasley. The pellet with the poisonly is the chalice with the...
Come in, Mr. Elliot.
The childhood he spent in medicine shows, circuses, burlesque, and vaudeville finally paid off for Red Skelton in the 1940s when he won a title he still holds, the Clown Prince of Hollywood.
Well, 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 look who's here. Mr. Apollo. Stomach in, chest out, shoulders back, head up.
It's hooked on back there.
Well, hold it up high and hack like a proud horse.
Move over, Nell.
One, two, three, and four, and five, and six, and seven, and... Fire!
Thank you.
salad. Would Monsieur care for another bottle of the Chateau Latour?
Yes, but no more 1966. Let's splurge. Bring us some fresh wine, the freshest you've got this year. No more of this old stuff.
Carrying on the great tradition are two of today's top clowns, Bernadette Peters and Steve Martin in The Jerk.
Marie, now just stay calm. Stay calm. Just don't look down. Don't look down. Look up. Just keep your eyes up and keep them that way, okay? Waiter?
There are snails on her plate.
Now get them out of here before she sees them. Look away. Just look away and keep your eyes that way. You would think in a fancy restaurant like this, at these prices, you would be able to keep the snails off the food. There's so many snails in there, you can't even see the food. Now take them away and bring me those melted cheese sandwich appetizers you talked me out of.
Oui, monsieur.
You believe this? First they didn't have the bamboo umbrellas for the wine, and now snails on the food.
Two boobs. That's what he takes us for.
Boom. Boom. All right. Boom. But you, let's do a little singing this morning. Boom.
One of Hollywood's most promising clowns is Bill Murray.
Play, 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 play. Feel great.
Feel great.
Wine winner.
Wine winner.
Hog on.
Hog on.
In clowning his way through stripes, Bill Murray joins that small but growing number of television personalities who more than measure up to size on the big screen.
Boom, shakalaka, boom, shakalaka, boom, shakalaka, boom.
Where the hell have you been, soldier?
Training, sir!
Training, sir!
What kind of training, son?
Army training, sir!
Army training, sir!
Razzle, dazzle!
1, 2, 3, 4! 1, 2, 3, 4! First round, fast jump! Over the lazy door! Sir!
Where's your drill sergeant, men?
Float up, sir!
Float up, sir!
So am I to understand that you men completed your training on your own?
That's the fact, Jack!
That's the fact, Jack!
There's a special sort of magic that happens when two solo performers team up for a film which is so successful and the experience so enjoyable that the same partners try to recapture that chemistry again. By far, Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn were Hollywood's most distinguished occasional team. Of the 9 films they made together, 5 were comedies, and Adam's Rib was one of their very best.
An impartial juror in this proceeding between the people of the state of New York and Doris Zalbo Attinger, so help you God.
I do. Please be seated. State your name and address.
Dr. Margaret Brody, 58 East 88th Street.
Said the same thing 9 times.
Oh, that's 10th time, and will you please stay out of this Attinger thing, darling? Will you please?
Did you have to sulk all evening with a growl on your face?
How could a man have a growl on his face? If you think you're going to turn a court of law into a Punch and Judy show,
darling,
I want to tell
please,
you, you don't...
Please, this means a
would
great
you?
Deal to me.
Yes, would you?
And
would
it's
you?
Not a stunt.
Would you?
This
would
poor
you?
Woman, isn't yes. she entitled to the same justice? I mean, that's usually reserved for men. The same unwritten law that got Lenihan off.
Would you?
I know what
please,
you're going to say.
Please,
that he should have been convicted,
just,
too,
just
but he wasn't.
Couldn't
and
I
you're not going to put this
just
stole away just because she had the misfortune
small,
to be born a
just
female.
Just one word
now,
in edgewise.
If I
couldn't
what?
I? Could I please get a word in edgewise?
Go ahead.
Not one syllable. Not one syllable of
you
what
do
you
excited.
Have been blabbering here tonight.
You always do that when you get excited.
I am going to cut you into 12 little pieces and feed you to the jury, so get prepared for it.
Good night, Pinky.
Oh, good night. Hey, things are picking up.
Case the local architecture.
Yeah, built like brick pagodas.
Bing Crosby and Bob Hope certainly had successful careers as solo performers. But when they teamed up for the popular Road series, audiences could count on an unprecedented barrage of wisecracks and ad-libs.
This road led to Bally.
I could try.
I don't know which way to turn. Everything looks so good.
Oh, don't get tied down. This may just be the older stuff, you know.
Oh, no.
What's that?
It's Errol Flynn. He can't stand it.
Okay, so make yourself available, huh?
Yes, we'll meet you at the drive-in.
Stand by. You'll hear from our local branch.
I'll send you my suit size and everything.
Isn't it nice to know we still got that old magnetism?
Hey, that sea air must have recharged our batteries.
I feel like I've had a complete overhaul.
Oh, if we can get our speedometers turned back now, we're in business.
Oh, wouldn't that be lovely?
Don't look now, but Taboo and his brother are still with us.
Well, don't worry about them. Let them get their own girls, huh?
Wonder if they must...
And where there's Hope and Crosby, there's also Dorothy L'Amour.
Well.
Your turn. Tilt.
Your Highness, may I present our guests?
Highness?
Gentlemen, you are in the presence of my cousin, Princess Lala of the Two.
Oh, well, the name's Gridley, Princess. Harold Gridley. Sportsman, raconteur, polo player, and all-around good egg.
Well, don't lay it here, huh?
Welcome to that too, gentlemen.
George Cochrane at your service, Your Highness.
Oh, the continental.
Go, run, play with the peasants. I'll take care of the royalty, do you mind?
Oh, me?
Always fight over girls.
Well, what else can we fight over? We've never had any money. That's for Washington.
During their illustrious careers, these two Oscar-winning actors have shared the screen four times. The title of this outing perfectly describes the marvelous chemistry between them. Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau, the odd couple.
All right, how long is this going to go on?
You talking to me?
Yeah, I'm talking to you.
What do you want to know?
I just want to know if you're going to spend the rest of your life not talking to me. And if you are, I'm going to get a radio.
You had your chance to talk last night. I begged you to come upstairs with me. Here's a key to the back door. Now, you stick to the hallway in your room and you won't get hurt.
Meaning what?
Meaning that if you want to live here, I don't want to see you, I don't want to hear you, I don't want to smell your cooking, all right? Now, kindly remove that spaghetti from my poker table. The hell is so funny?
It's not spaghetti, it's linguine.
Now it's garbage.
You're crazy. I'm a neurotic nut, but you're crazy.
I'm crazy, huh? Boy, that's really funny coming from a fruitcake like you.
Uh-huh. I'm not cleaning that up.
Is that a promise?
Did you hear what I said? I'm not cleaning that up. That's your mess. Look at it. Look at it. It's hanging all over the wall.
I like it.
You'd just let it hang there, wouldn't you? Just let it hang until it got all hard and brown and... That's disgusting. Well, I'm cleaning it.
Leave that alone.
I've got to...
You leave that alone. You touch one strand of that linguine, and I'm going to punch you right
now
in your side.
You better put this up. Hey, Oscar, come on now. Now, listen, why don't you just take a tranquilizer?
Go to your room. Yes, I go to your room.
Yeah, let's just all settle down, huh?
I'm warning you, Felix. You want to live through this night, you better keep this door locked and lock your windows, too.
Harry, I don't think I'm going to make it.
Hang on, man. Don't mess up. Just think about our people.
Here's one occasional team that audiences pray will keep on reuniting forever. Gene Wilder and Richard Pryor in Stir Crazy show what teamwork is all about.
Excuse me, sir. Could I please... Wait a minute. I'm not a troublemaker.
Skip!
Skip! Okay, no more hitting. Did you hear what I just said?
Skip!
No more hitting.
Skip!
All right, turn around. You want to stay late tonight? I said turn around. Okay, let's get out of here. Come on, Silver!
Skip!
Harry, I'm freaking!
Skip!
Giddy up! So long, suckers! Hey, Harry! He thinks he's a horse! Help me! Harry!
Do him! Do him! Please! He's sick! He's having a fit! See, he don't have his foot pills! He's got them! Where's your...
He's got worse. Vietnam, please, Italy.
Harry, help me, Harry. It's okay. It's okay. You did it. You did it.
He's okay now.
I'm okay. I'm okay now. Side of my sister.
You okay?
Yeah.
He's okay.
I'm 100%.
He's okay, see?
Yeah. Yeah, we're all okay.
It's okay?
Yeah.
I'm tip top.
Harry, for God's sake. You're gonna get us in trouble. Harry, it's all right.
I can't take it. Wait a minute.
Harry,
Mama.
Here. Come here, here, Harry.
Mama!
Take your pill. Take your pill. There are 3 seconds. You'll see. It's over. 1001. 1002. 1003. Finished! Finished! What'd I tell you? Okay. Let's go. Back to line. Here we go. Thanks very much.
Okay.
Here we go. What's next?
This way.
Come on.
Wait.
Go.
Hey!
Once in a while, a comedy film appears that takes the critics, the audience, and even the movie industry itself by surprise. Remember Airplane?
Can you fly this plane and land it?
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious, and don't call me Shirley.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your stewardess speaking. We hope you enjoy the rest of your flight. By the way, is there anyone on board who knows how to fly a plane?
I've got to get out of here. I've got to get out of here.
Calm down. Get a hold of yourself.
Stewardess, please, let me handle this.
Get. Calm down. Now get back to your seat. I'll take care of this contract. Calm down. Get a hold of yourself.
Doctor, you're running on the phone. Everything's going to be all right.
Sister, please, now handle this.
I've
got to
get out of here. I've got to get out of here.
Coming in too fast. Watch your speed. He's coming right at us. Coming in too hot. Ease up on the throttle. Watch for that crosswind. Level it out.
Airplane's roots go back 60 years to the wacky and wonderful films that were made here at the Max Sennett Studios. This, without question, was the cradle of screen comedy. Today, it's hard to conceive of an entire movie studio devoted exclusively to producing hundreds of comedies a year. But whether we care to admit it or not, all comedians have been influenced by the Max Sennett School of Comedy. And if Sennett degrees were still being handed out, this man would be at the head of the class, Walter Matthau.
If you think that this one-time shooting stage is all that's left of Max Sennett, you're wrong. The Sennett legacy lives on today in just about every film comedy that's made. When you see Chevy Chase take a fall, that was already perfected by Sennett's people. And when Cheech and Chong gross out, well, the Sennett gang made even a bigger mess in their day. And following his vision of screen comedy, Sennett made stars out of more comedians than any other filmmaker in motion picture history. Fatty Arbuckle, Mabel Normand, Ben Turpin, Charlie Chase, Harry Langdon, Charlie Chaplin. The list goes on and on. Max Sennett certainly lived up to his billing. The king of comedy. Max Sennett was a gruff and fun-loving filmmaker who didn't mind kidding himself. An ex-boilermaker from Canada, he was an aspiring opera singer who eventually drifted into early films, first as an actor, then as an assistant to the famed director D.W. Griffith. Pretty girls in scanty costumes, Sennett decided, might be acceptable in comedies, and so the bathing beauties were born. The Blue Noses complained, but most moviegoers didn't seem to mind these tantalizing glimpses of the fair sex.
Legend has it that the first pie in the face occurred in this Senate comedy. The culprit, Ford Sterling. The victim, Mabel Norman. Senate's company of clowns quickly perfected this surefire device. Fatty Arbuckle got his. And Charlie Chaplin became an expert marksman. But Max Sennett's greatest joy was his invention of the Keystone Cops, a troupe of madcap comedians who made a mockery of the nation's men in blue. In Sennett's films, frantic pacing always won out over content. Once we let anybody stop to analyze us, said Max Sennett, we're sunk. In 1915, Sennett fired a skinny teenaged bit player whom he considered hopeless as a comic. In desperation, the young actor teamed up with a former extra and would-be producer. Harold Lloyd not only became a star, but his partner Hal Roach would become Sennett's greatest competitor. Lloyd, as the all-American go-getter, was the master of thrill comedy. Audiences adored his films, and many moviegoers actually fainted while watching these scenes from Harold Lloyd's classic, Safety Last. It should be mentioned that Harold Lloyd seldom used a double for his stunts, and what's even more remarkable, he performed his dangerous antics without the use of his right thumb and forefinger. Lloyd's impairment was concealed by a flesh-colored glove and was one of Hollywood's best-kept secrets. Snared the most gifted sight gag specialist of the silent era. But he missed out on the great stone face, Buster Keaton. Cleavon's works are marvels of invention and execution. Buster had been a child star, a human mop, and the most violent knockabout family act in vaudeville history. And so he was able to use his acrobatic talents to great advantage. In Steamboat Bill Jr., Buster devised the most ingenious and dangerous comedy stunt ever filmed. Behind him, the building's two-ton facade is about to give way. The distance between a brilliant sight gag and tragedy is a matter of inches. In films like Seven Chances, Keaton's genius and grace are wonderful to behold. His incredible imagination stretched silent comedy to its outermost boundaries. Both physically and creatively, Buster Keaton ranks as one of the finest comedy talents of all time. This silly-looking dandy would soon become the funniest man in the world. Max Sennett discovered a fella called Charlie Chaplin in a touring English music hall review and signed him to his first film, an undistinguished effort called Making a Living. Charlie Chaplin realized that if he wanted to continue making a living with Sennett, he would have to create a new character. So the mustache was trimmed and over and undersized pieces of clothing were borrowed from other comics. And thus, out of desperation, Charlie Chaplin's Little Fellow was born. A year later, Chaplin had left Sennett and was writing and directing his own films. But the Sennett traditions of crudeness and cruelty were still evident, as in this scene with Ben Turpin. Gradually, Chaplin's comedies became more graceful, less violent. Audiences were astonished and delighted at Charlie's brilliant antics, but he was determined to find a new form, a new dimension to screen comedy. In 1921, Chaplin found the formula he'd been seeking. His first feature-length comedy, The Kid, co-starred Little Jackie Coogan. In this masterpiece, Chaplin combined humor with the reality and sentiment of a touching story, a chemistry that had never before been attempted on the screen. The Kid was a daring experiment that worked, and with its success, Charlie Chaplin charted a new course in the development of motion picture comedy. In 1925, Chaplin began a series of classic silent comedies that still have the critics squabbling over which was the finest achievement. Charlie's delicate pantomime in sharing a boiled shoe with Max Swain is certainly an unforgettable moment from the Gold Rush.
Mm-hmm.
1928, Chaplin won a well-deserved honorary Oscar for his versatility and genius in writing, acting, directing, and producing The Circus. City Lights appeared in 1931. Chaplin all but ignored the arrival of sound films. His only concession was the use of sound effects and a musical score which he composed and conducted himself. Modern Times appeared in 1936, long after sound films dominated the screen. It was Chaplin's last silent film, and it marks the end of the silent era. This day, despite a turbulent and controversial off-screen life, the genius of Sir Charles Spencer Chaplin endures on film. He was, in the words of Max Sennett, the greatest motion picture artist who ever lived.
Motion picture history here. I want quiet. Quiet from everybody.
Oh, drunk again.
An ex-comedy juggler on Broadway, W.C. Fields made motion picture history by creating a character that defied Hollywood's rules for success.
You were up late last night.
The Duchess and I sat up at 4 o'clock. Killed 3 quarts of rye.
As an aging, hard-drinking, dishonest, anti-social grump, he astounded audiences with his outrageous behavior. Water, he declared, was unfit for human consumption because it rusted pipes and fish made love in it.
It is a pleasure, an honor, to break bread.
Fields also pretended to detest children, especially an adorable co-star named Baby Leroy.
Well, little man, you know who I am?
Dada!
He's a brat. A brat. A B-R-A-T. Brat.
See here, young man. That is, if I'm not mistaken, what is your name and where do you hail from?
You like children.
I do if they're properly cooked.
Give me your...
What's the matter, Pop? Don't you love me?
Don't you dare strike that child.
You're not going to tell me I don't love her.
Jack, put that down.
What's the matter, Pop? Don't you love me anymore?
Certainly I love you.
Don't you strike that child.
Well, he's not going to tell me I don't love him.
There he goes again, down to the saloon to read that silly detective magazine.
Well, all right. You've been smoking again in your room.
Imagine a man who takes money out of a child's piggy bank and puts in IOUs.
Don't you dare strike that child! You put that down! Put it down! Put it down!
Only W.C. Fields could get away with a moment like this. Some of Fields' best work appeared in a handful of seldom-seen comedy shorts produced by Max Sennett. The Barbershop is a prime example of the art of W.C. Fields.
Say, what's that dog doing in here?
Oh, it's a very funny thing. The other day, a man was in here, and I was shaving him. The razor slipped, and I cut his ear off. The dog got him. Ever since, he's been hanging around here for... Go away, go away, go away. He's going to get another... He can't get another... Da-dum-dum. That's easy now. Okay. Wasn't your fault. I can fix that. No harm done. No harm done.
W.C. Fields finally met his match when he co-starred with Mae West in My Little Chickadee.
Pardon me. May I present my card?
Novelties, assumptions. What kind of notions you got?
You'd be surprised. Some are old, some are new.
Mae West's impact on movie audiences was absolutely phenomenal. As a Broadway star, she had developed the unique ability to portray herself as a sex symbol and to deliberately make fun of that image at the same time. After appearing in only five films, Mae West became the highest salaried woman in America. Surrounding herself with handsome young leading men like Cary Grant, Mae provided a steady stream of racy dialogue that shocked and delighted the nation.
I always did like a man in a uniform.
That one fits you grand. Why don't you come up sometime and see me? I'm home every evening.
Yeah, but I'm busy every evening.
Busy? So what are you trying to do, insult me?
Why, no, no, not at all. I'm just busy, that's all.
I heard you. But you ain't kidding me any. You know, I met your kind before. Why don't you come up sometime, huh?
Well, I...
Don't be afraid. I won't tell.
But,
Come up. I'll tell your fortune. Oh, you can be had. Come up again. Anytime.
I shall. Then I hope you will be alone.
So do I. Warm, dark, and handsome.
Your bath is ready, Miss Lou.
You take it. I'm indisposed. Oh, honey, how's business?
Fine.
You been insulted lately?
Goodness, what beautiful diamonds.
Goodness had nothing to do with it, dearie. Mm-hmm.
Why did you admit knowing so many men in your life?
Well, it's not the men in your life that counts. It's the life in your men.
Oh.
Ruby, I must have you. Your golden hair, your fascinating eyes, and alluring smile, and lovely arms. Your form divine.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Is this a proposal or you take an inventory? Yeah, for a long time I was ashamed of the way I lived.
You mean to say you reformed?
No, I got over being ashamed. I might crack a law now and then, but I ain't never broke one.
The only law you ain't ever broke is the law of gravity.
That's an idea. I'll go to work on that right away. Those absolutely necessary? You know, I wasn't born with them.
No, a lot of men would have been safer if you had.
Oh, I don't know. Hands ain't everything.
You were wonderful tonight.
I'm always wonderful at night.
Yes, but tonight you were especially good.
Well, when I'm good, I'm very good. But when I'm bad, I'm better. I want you, need you. Your love must be mine, oh baby, baby. To have you would be paradise. What are you gonna do about it, huh?
Mae West, an authentic American legend. The big broadcast of 1938, co-starring Shirley Ross, is memorable for two reasons. An Oscar-winning tune, and the debut of the wisecracking young musical comedy star who sang it, Bob Hope.
Thanks for the memory of rainy afternoons, swingy Harlem tunes, motor trips and burning lips and burning toast and prune. I thank you so much.
Nearly 20 years later, in that certain feeling with Eva Marie Saint, Bob Hope was barely halfway through a career that simply staggers the imagination. As the world's busiest entertainer, Bob's been making people laugh for over 50 years.
Wish he that certain feeling, I'm here to confess it, is so appealing, no words can express it. I can't hide it, I must confide it, I'm feeling that feeling too.
You got the courage of a lion, Doctor.
Oh, it's nothing. Brave men run in my family.
Come on. Hurry up, folks, we're off to Buffalo Flat. Off to Buffalo Flat! Yahoo! Off to Buffalo Flat! Yahoo! Off to Buffalo!
That certain feeling, first time I met you, I hit the ceiling, I cannot forget you. I felt it happen just as you came in view. Grew sort of dizzy, thought, gee, who is she? That certain feeling, I'm here to confess it, is so appealing, no words can express it. I cannot hide it, I must confide it. I'm feeling that feeling too.
As Hollywood's foremost wolf, Bob has always had an eye for beautiful girls like Dorothy L'Amour. Our hero has only one flaw. He's a devout coward.
Long distance, San Francisco. I don't know anybody in San Francisco. Operator, I'm cut off. I'm shot off.
Run, Michael, run!
Run? Do you think I'm yellow? Shake hands with the lemon. Let's go.
But you can't get out of here. They have access to the building. You'll never get past that door alive.
Oh, no?
No.
Listen, baby, if I'm not out of that door in 2 seconds flat, my name's not Larry Haynes. Meet John Doe.
What does the legislature...
Bob Hope's incredible sense of timing was never more evident than in My Favorite Brunette. The supporting cast included Dorothy L'Amour, Lon Chaney Jr., Charles Arndt, and a superbly sinister Peter Lorre.
Sneaking out, stranger?
Oh,
it's you.
No.
Practicing again?
No, wait, don't leave me. Practicing?
How delightful.
Wonderful. Wait a minute. Take it easy, Cuddles.
Cuddles, huh?
Look, I was just... Marvelous! Come here, you coward. Look, you can get in trouble if you... Why, you dirty rat. Nothing personal.
Rat.
Come here. Where are you? Hey, where...
You...
Temper.
I hear you.
Why, you stupid...
Pardon
me.
You
marvelous. You broke it.
Honey, I'll drive.
Yeah, you drive and I'll watch. Finally going on your honeymoon?
Am I?
Yahoo!
What do you want, a happy ending?
Benjamin.
Are we at the fort?
Yes, we are. Time to wake up now.
Oh, in a sec.
Get your butt up and out on the company street!
Ah! What is this, Hell Week?
No, Benjamin. This is the Army.
This is Goldie Hawn, today's most popular screen comedian.
Excuse me, sir, is green the only color these come in?
Private Benjamin is one of Goldie's crowning achievements. Hal Williams and Eileen Brennan provide impeccable support.
I hate to interrupt you, but could I speak to you for a sec?
My Lord, Sergeant, would you look at this?
I've seen it, ma'am.
What's your name, Princess? Huh?
Judy.
Judy.
Judy Benjamin.
Judy Benjamin.
I think they sent me to the wrong place.
Uh-huh.
See, I did join the Army, but I joined a different Army. Uh-huh. I joined the one with the condos and the private rooms. What? No, really, my recruiter, Jim Ballard,
I don't care what your lousy recruiter told you, Benjamin. Now, I'm telling you, there is no other Army.
Wait a minute. I don't want to have to go to your boss or anything, okay? I just... Look, to be truthful with you, I can't sleep in a room with 20 strangers.
Oh, dear.
And, I mean, look at this. The Army couldn't afford drapes. I mean, I'll be up at the crack of dawn here. And I have to tell you, I am frankly a little shocked.
You're shocked?
Yes.
Why?
This place is a sty.
It's a sty?
Yeah, I mean, look. Look at these stains. God uh-huh. knows where this has been.
Well, that's because this is the Army, Benjamin. It's not a sorority house.
Goldie Hawn's stardom is quite an achievement. Since the movies began, comedians have had to be exceptional to succeed on the screen. Max Sennett's Bathing Beauties provided the first wave of talented ladies that proved that comedy wasn't just a man's game. At first, sex appeal was the main attraction. But from their ranks would emerge many young stars who would go on to show that you didn't have to look funny to be funny. This California beachcomber wasn't even born yet when the Senate girls frolicked here. Maybe now Jack Lemmon wishes he was older.
An old-timer once described the beaches of Santa Monica as Max Sennett's sandbox. And in those days, I guess that was pretty close to the truth. You know, plenty of sunshine, a nice stretch of beach. Beautiful girls in bathing suits. Well, that was a formula that Max Sennett found seldom failed. His graduates, of course, included Gloria Swanson, Louise Fazenda, and Mabel Normand, perhaps the most popular comedienne of the silent era. But when sound films came in, slapstick went out. Audiences quickly became fascinated by tough-talking cuties, you know, like Jean Harlow, Ann Southern, and Joan Blondell. But eventually, it was the sophisticated ladies, actresses first, comedians second, that really dominated the so-called screwball comedies of the 30s. Stars like Irene Dunne, Claudette Colbert, Rosalind Russell, they shot up to the top and they just stayed there. But joining them, ironically, was a former Senate girl. And she would become one of Hollywood's most talented and glamorous stars, Carol Lombard. She brought all of the wit and the charm and the warmth and the talent of her real-life personality. In 1942, Carol was Mrs. Clark Gable. She was at the peak of her career when she was tragically killed in a USO plane crash. But, thank heaven, film lives on. And Carol Lombard will always be with us, as she is now in this scene with Frederick March from Nothing Sacred.
Come on, Delilah. Up with your dukes.
Oh, I can't. I'm sick of faking and lying.
Take that ice pack off your head and fight.
No, what's the use? Why fool them any longer?
Because I love you. Because I'm going to marry you, and I don't want to spend my honeymoon hanging around Sing Sing blowing kisses to you in the exercise yard. Come on, stop dogging it. Come on, keep moving, snake brains. Come on, get going, you little crook. Come on, keep moving, my little fraud.
I'll never forgive you as long as I live. I won't. I just hate you. I just hate you. Let go of me. Let go of me. Oh, I hate you.
You're going to have plenty of reason to hate me. I'm going to show you cards and spades and lying for the next 50 years. I'm going to pay you back for every lie you're told. I'm going to flirt and lie and cheat and swindle right through to our golden wedding.
Yeah, let me hit you just once.
All right, come on. That's it. Come on, keep coming. Faster, faster.
Oh, Wally, why, I didn't mean to do it. I didn't mean to do it. I love you. I love you.
Yes, Mr. Martin?
They said that she was too pretty to play comedy, but Lucille Ball would show them.
Yes, I will. Oh! Sally, where are you?
In The Fuller Brush Girl, Lucy gave us a glimpse of the daffy but adorable character that she would later portray on the most popular comedy series in television history.
Mr. Simpson, it was just an Come on, Jane, I'm quitting.
Stop that girl!
Oh, no!
Oh, no. Go on, play your cards.
In Born Yesterday, with Broderick Crawford, the brilliant Judy Holliday won an Oscar for her memorable portrayal of a far from dumb blonde.
It's a free country.
That's what you think.
Baby.
Do
gin.
When she wasn't singing or dancing, Debbie Reynolds was busy getting laughs. Here's one of her funniest moments in How Sweet It Is with James Garner and Vito Scotti.
Miss Lee!
Wait a minute! Don't try that old trick with me!
What old trick?
You're guilty as hell, so you're trying to make me think I've got something to be ashamed of. Well, I'm not the one who's running around flaunting my belly button.
Oh, a bikini is a very acceptable piece of wearing apparel.
Well, good. I'll take off my pants and we can run around the streets together.
All of a sudden, a bikini is lewd. Am I supposed to shrivel up and wear a shawl just because I'm your wife?
You are a middle-aged mother.
Oh, sir, is this the body of a middle-aged mother?
Are you happy? You just proved you have the power to drive men mad.
Price? I don't want to be in the finale.
Who can forget Barbara Streisand in Funny Girl?
What was that you said?
Well, I can't sing words like I am the beautiful reflection of my love's affection.
Why not?
Well, it's embarrassing.
Miss Bryce, may I remind you that you're in my theater?
So nobody argues with the landlord.
Walter Pidgeon played producer Flo Ziegfeld, and Barbara's hilarious performance won her an Oscar in her very first film.
Of my love's affection, a walking illustration of his adoration.
His love makes you beautiful, so beautiful.
Tell me, why is there so much human suffering?
This is unanswerable.
Is there a God?
These are the wrong questions.
Look, here's my point. If nothing lasts, why am I bothering to make films or do anything for that matter?
We enjoy your films, particularly the early funny ones.
But shouldn't I stop making movies and do something that counts, like helping blind people or becoming a missionary or something?
Let me tell you, you're not the missionary type. You'd never last. And incidentally, you're also not Superman. You're a comedian. You want to do mankind a real service? Tell funnier jokes.
Yeah, but I've got to find meaning.
Well, I thought it was terrible. Absolutely terrible. I don't recall seeing anything.
You're not kidding. This man is sick.
Hey, what self-indulgence?
Okay,
I think the man's lost his mind.
I've seen it all before. They try to document their private suffering and fob it off as art.
What does he have to suffer about? Doesn't the man know he's got the greatest gift that anyone can have, the gift of laughter?
This man is dangerous. He's been known to tickle our mind, break our heart, twist our funny bone. Woody Allen actually makes us laugh at our own fears and anxieties. These days, that's a major accomplishment.
Thank you.
Allen has been nominated 6 times. He's won the Academy Award 2. I don't think that's so bad for a fellow who portrays himself as a lovable loser. Woody's turf is our psyche. You know, his constant probing into the tangled emotions of contemporary men and women. That probably cuts closer to the bone than any other filmmaker. But he's an incurable romantic. He really cares about the characters that he creates. And here to present his unique point of view are some scenes from some of his films that give new meaning to that old phrase, boy meets girl. And the girl, if he ever finds her, is usually portrayed by the very brilliant Diane Keaton. So here is Love Among the Neurotics, Woody Allen style.
This is Sharon.
Hello.
I've got to make one quick call.
Linda, are you wearing jasmine?
Me?
No. Well, let's see now. What are we drinking?
I'll have a J&B on the rocks.
I'll have a little Harvey's Bristol for you, please.
I'll have the usual. Bourbon and water.
Oh, a bourbon man.
I got to cut down on my drinking. I'm beginning to put away a quart a day. I'm no longer at Fort Wayne. I'm going to be at Mr. Feet. What time did that come in? Yeah.
Do you think you could turn the music down a little bit?
Of course.
Oh! Gee, Alan, you really have a delicate touch.
Alan is a trifle tense. He had a little misfortune with his wife.
His wife?
She left him.
I'm sorry.
You busy tonight?
Some old friends are coming over. We're going to show some pornographic movies.
You need an usher?
You interested in dancing at all?
Get lost, creep.
What'd she say?
She'd rather not.
What are you doing Saturday night?
Committing suicide.
What about Friday night?
It must be lonely at the front. How long has it been since you've made love to a woman?
What's today? Monday, Tuesday, 2 years.
2 years? You remember how, of course.
Well, if you start me, it'll all come back.
Alan, I won't deny it. I'm a nymphomaniac. I discovered sex very early. I slept with everybody. My school teacher, my sister's husband. The string section of the New York Philharmonic.
I want to have sex all the time. Play all the time. Otherwise, you're just down. And why be down? The best way to get up is sex. I'm not like my sisters. They're so inhibited. They never want to do anything. I believe in having sex as often, as freely, and as intensely as possible.
Well, thank you again.
Oh, yeah. Hey, listen, hey, you want to come upstairs and have a glass of wine or something? I mean, you don't have to. You're probably late and everything.
No, it'll be fine. I won't mind. Sure. No, I got time. Sure. I got nothing to my analyst appointment.
You see an analyst?
Yeah, just for 15 years.
15 years?
Yeah. I'm going to give him one more year, and then I'm going to Lourdes.
15? Nah, come on. Yeah, really?
Well, okay, well, tell me, why'd you get a divorce?
Why? I got a divorce because my ex-wife left me for another woman. Okay?
Really?
Mm-hmm.
God, that must have been really demoralizing.
Well, I don't know. I thought I took it rather well under the circumstances.
Ooh-wee.
I tried to run them both over with a car. You have a great voice.
Really? Do you think so, really?
Yeah.
Yeah?
It's terrific.
Yeah, you know something? I never even took a lesson either.
Hey, listen. You know? Listen.
What?
Give me a kiss.
Really?
Yeah, why not? Because we're just going to go home later, right? And then there's going to be all that tension, you know, we never kissed before, and I'll never know when to make the right move or anything. So we'll kiss now, we'll get it over with, and then we'll go eat, okay?
Oh.
We'll digest our food better.
Okay.
Okay? So now we can digest our food, okay? Yeah.
You were fantastic last night in bed.
Oh, thanks.
How do you feel now?
I think the Pepto-Bismol helped. What were you thinking about while we were doing it?
Willie Mays.
You always think of baseball players when you're making love?
Keeps me going.
Yeah, I couldn't figure out why you kept yelling slide. Boris, I just don't love you.
Oh, Sonia.
Oh, I mean I love you, but I'm not in love with you.
Sonia, do you even know what love means?
There are many different kinds of love, Boris. There's love between a man and a woman, love between a mother and a son.
Two women. Let's not forget my favorite.
But then there's the love I've always dreamed of ever since I was a little girl.
Yeah?
The love between two extraordinary individuals.
Sonia.
Oh, don't, Boris, please. Sex without love is an empty experience.
Yes, but as empty experiences go, it's one of the best.
I don't want any alimony. You can have everything. I just went out.
Well, can't we discuss it?
We discussed it 50 times. It's no use.
Why?
I don't know. I can't stand the marriage. I don't find you any fun. I feel you suffocate me. I don't feel any rapport with you, and I don't think you physically. Oh, for God's sake, Alan, don't take it personal.
Well, I won't take it personal. I'll just kill myself, that's all.
It's not going to work out. It's no use to you, Dave. I'm sorry.
Goodbye.
I'm sorry if I hurt you.
Don't worry about me, sweetheart. I'm like a cat. I'll always wind up on my feet.
Oh. This is shaping up like a Noel Coward play, you know? Somebody should go out and make some martinis.
I don't blame you for being furious with me.
I'm too stunned to be furious.
Well, then I wish you would. I wish you'd get angry so that we could have it out, so that we could get it out in the open.
I don't get angry, okay? I mean, I have a tendency to internalize. I can't express anger. That's one of the problems I have. I grow a tumor instead.
Well, I told you that I was troubled from the beginning, from when we first started dating.
So what does your analyst say? I mean, did you speak to him?
Well, Donnie's in a coma. He had a very bad acid experience.
Oh, that's great. I think you're making a big mistake here.
Why?
Why? Because you're preferring Yale to me. And so I know that sounds egotistical, but, you know. This guy's been married for 12 years to Emily. What do you think's going to happen? He'll be away for a month. He'll go crazy. And if he does commit to you, you know, and you start to feel secure, you'll drop him. I know it. I give the whole thing 4 weeks.
Well,
that's it.
I can't plan that far in advance.
You can't plan 4 weeks in advance?
No.
I mean, what kind of foresight is that? You know, I knew you were crazy when we started going out. You always think that you're going to be the one that makes him act different, you know, but...
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I really am. I'm really sorry.
Uh-huh.
Where are you going?
I got to get some air.
Oh.
It's amazing, Hush. From this he makes a living? I like a melodrama. A musical comedy with a plot.
Woody Allen indeed has the gift of laughter, but his biting wit is tempered with great compassion, especially for those of us today who share the same anxieties. Boy, do we need him now.
The question is, have I learned anything about life? Only that human beings are divided into mind and body. The mind embraces all the nobler aspirations like poetry and philosophy, but the body has all the fun. The important thing, I think, is not to be bitter. You know, if it turns out that there is a God, I don't think that he's evil. I think that the worst you can say about him is that basically he's an underachiever. After all, you know, there are worse things in life than death. I mean, if you've ever spent an evening with an insurance salesman, you know exactly what I mean. The key here, I think, is to not think of death as an end, but think of it more as a very effective way of cutting down on your expenses. Regarding love, you know, what can you say? It's not the quantity of your sexual relations that count. It's the quality. On the other hand, if the quantity drops below once every 8 months, I would definitely look into it. Well, that's about it for me, folks. Goodbye.
We hope you've enjoyed Hollywood, The Gift of Laughter. Our salute to the city of Los Angeles, where most of these movies were made. There are thousands of films and hundreds of funny men and women we haven't been able to include this time. Just wait. LA's tricentennial is only 100 years from now. Until then, goodbye. Oh, I'll see you at the movies.
Something familiar, something peculiar, something for everyone, a comedy tonight. Something appealing, something appalling, something for everyone, a comedy tonight.
Can you ever forgive me?
It is not for me to forgive you, but this little flower you have wronged. She is innocent.
I didn't realize.
Of course you didn't realize. You didn't realize because you don't know women. But if there's one thing Bob Hope knows, it's women. Goodbye, and remember, that little wife of yours is as honest as the day is long.
Short day, wasn't it?
Nothing for kings, nothing for crowns. Bring on the lovers, liars, and clowns. Old situations, new complications. Nothing portentous or polite. Tragedy tomorrow, comedy tonight.
Is your dear goodbye?
No. Oh.
Nice digger. I thought you said your dog did not bite.
That is not my talk.
Something familiar, something peculiar, something for everyone and funny tonight. Something that's gaudy, something that's haughty, something for everybody today.
Pantaloons and tunics, partisans and eunuchs, funerals and chases,
baritones and basses,
panderers,
philanderers,
cupidity, timidity,
mistakes,
fakes,
rhymes,
mimes,
humblers,
rumblers, humblers, humblers,
no royal curse, no Trojan horse, and there's a happy ending, of course. Goodness and badness, man in his madness, this time it all turns out all right.
Comedy, 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 comedy.